And welcome back. This is the RPG Chick. And this is Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. Where are we gonna look here? Well, this is still going. A day of 25 hours. Resolve attack. 6 hours remaining. Hordes of undead marching from Radric's hold. Be at our gates. Don't the gates close? You're going to auto-resolve this. I'm not sure, completely sure, how this is going to play out, because I've never done this before. I'm assuming that they would come from that bridge, because, well, they're kind of north of us, actually. They could go around the other way, but I'm not sure. So we could either wait. I don't think that's what we should do, though. I think we should click manual resolve. Let's see what this is like. Let's show these undead. We are newly rested. With the woodland trails bonus, and here are undead. Vampire, Dargles, a skeletal wizard. We can see everything here. Okay, good. The Dunreed Scion and the Glamfellen Soul Hunter will help. A Vanguard soldier back there. All right, so I'd say can the area effect spells rather. Apparently that will help them as well. Unfortunately, these guys won't be included in the Holy Radiance. Now we'll start right off with a disintegration spell. Why is that one selected when I do that? I guess it would hit them. Okay, on the vampire here then. Not that close. I'm not even sure. Now this will only jump to hostile targets, so hit that. Lightning bolt. Chain lightning, rather. Knockdown. Kinda can knock down that one. Finish this guy off. I think this one's safe. Area of effect, it's gonna hit everybody. Alright, let's just. Blessing. Blessing in disguise. Boop! More chain lightning. Out of focus. Attack the wizard. I have a fast weapon, so I have a good chance of interrupting his spells. And did we decide here? Oh, I didn't choose chain lightning. I chose this. Alright. Well, let's actually choose chain lightning now. See, when I do that, The skirmish archer all the way over there is highlighted. What the deal? I don't want to hit him too, you know? Knock down that one too. I did hit him, didn't I? The hell? Ah. Is he taken over or did I hit him? And now he wants to kill us. I don't know, guys, what's going on? Armor of Faith, Honor of Fighters here. Let's go for single targets here. Well, even that will ba- I think they turned him evil. That's what happened. That will bounce off, so... single target. Necrotic Lance.
Love.
Alright, you cast that, I guess? Oh. A last turn evil? He did, he turned evil. We're fighting him, right? A dare. Knock down the famp here. A little healing here. Now what am I doing? Skeletal Fighter. Oh, the Dunreed Scion's almost dead. Don't hit him. Hit him. Oh, that's Durance. Alright, well, Durance hit him. Theodas hit him. I have a feeling they're just standing around not doing anything. Even though people attack them. Just... that's basic AI. They should always defend themselves. You know what, Palagina? Suppress Affliction. I can't get both of them, can I?
I'm ready.
Oh, I had to disengage to do that? Okay, he's good. Can we heal him? Can we heal this guy? Good, we healed him. Skeletal Fighter. Vampire. Vanguard Soldier is... I can't tell if he's... let's do that clear thing. Clear out. See if we can heal a tear again. Okay, we have Aloth back. Necrotic Lance on the field.
Lavaru, be on seek!
I have a feeling because these guys don't have green circles under them unless I put the mouse over it, so they might be affected by these area of effect and rebounding spells. Palagina, I need your help again. Suppress affliction on this guy here. Disengage again.
Lavaru, be on seek!
It didn't work? Disintegration on, the vamp here. Kill him. Now who else has this? I know our cleric does. Just not sure what the icon is. Hold on a second. It's a picture of a head. Let's get ahead. All the way back here, okay. Suppress affliction on Glamfath and Soul Hunter, just do it. Oh, he just killed him! Man, killing our hunters? That ain't cool. You know what? I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna attack that, except for... Kinda's not tied, but a dare is. So. And now... Boom. Did I have fast on? The guy was moving really quickly. I think I did have it on. Fast mode. I was fighting the whole battle in fast mode.
Sure.
Deer wooden clothing, vessel flesh, 27 gold, 294 copper. Well, that was interesting. We resolved it manually. And the keep apparently still stands. Let's just walk inside here in case. Oh, we do have gates. Now we gotta load in just to get in here? Sheesh. When did the courtyard become a separate zone from outside, like the bridge area? Oh wait, no. It transported us over to that area, even though we were standing by the bridge. I got it. Alright, a little confused. In any case, I do want to walk around and make sure there's no more undead. And now we can go fast mode. Fast mode. Not pausing. Make our way over this way. Sorry, these guys died. I don't see any more. Nope. In 23 hours. Alright, suppose we gotta hire more. All we have left is that Vanguard soldier. Sheesh. They're all ten copper a day. They're all the same. Cleric. Gospel Knight. Gold Pack Knight. Missionary. Sorry, all these guys got killed. You can't hire any more hirelings. Okay. What are you trying to tell me, game? I can't afford it? Anyway. Oh, I do need to get back in here anyway.
Safe travels.
Going to see what the Grieving Mother has to say. If she wants to go somewhere, what she wants to do. She can level up. She's awfully young and pretty to be so grieving. Athletics. Two in athletics. Detonate is very tricky. I've yet to successfully use that spell. So how about Ringleader? I like that one. Oh, we can do another one? Borrowed Instinct. Or Tactical Meld. Sure, why not? I mean, I'm not going to use her as a party member. I'm a cipher. I don't need any competition. So I get to level her up again. Can't do athletics anymore. So, survival. Oh. Might as well take detonate after all. Brutal backlash. Sure. Ooh, what's that sound?
Anything to talk about? Your mind comes bearing questions, Watcher.
Okay. I'm not sure. Apparently I haven't asked her about this stuff. I heard the name Watcher in your thoughts when you remembered the birthing bell. Why?
It is because I once believed I was one, and others believed I was one.
There was a slow chill, and for a moment it seems as if she was going to fade from your vision, as if she can't bear to be seen. Why did you believe you were a Watcher? The world has many corners, and in some corners the name Watcher is more known. It is an easier title than others, and at times it is easier to wear. Placing a title upon what is unknown can dispel the fear of it, and I did not fight it. I even believed it true, though I knew little of the ways of Watchers. It even granted me strength. I was able to see the thoughts of others, shape them, and help guide souls. Watcher seemed enough, and the name seemed to matter little in light of one's acts. There is another name for someone with our abilities. This cipher does not define you any more than Watcher does. It diminishes the nature of who you are, dims the flame of thought and drive. Yet, if it calms others to define you in such a way, then comfort may be taken in that. That is a cloak as well that serves to dispel fear, hate. Do you know anything about Watchers? I feel that they were once marked, hated. Such hate feels dimmed now. I can feel it. Other hatreds have risen for other titles. But they burn bright in the past. Now hates have shifted focus, and they may fall on the same again, either you or I. Let me ask about something else. Can you tell me about the birthing bell?
The birthing bell It is where I could draw new souls into the world. I recall some of the memory of it through what you have seen, but not all.
Let's continue our journey for now. That's it. What am I supposed to do with her? Perhaps she'll open up more as our journeys continue. Let me just zone in somewhere and see if that does anything.
No problem.
And actually, all of us. Yeah. I'm not sure where I'm supposed to go with her. I mean, we followed the quest almost to the very end. Unless we have to be in Sun and Shadow or something in order for her quest to be completed.
Your mind comes bearing questions, Watcher.
Huh. Not sure. Okay. Apparently... I mean, I don't know what happens, but... What I need to do is either ask her a certain number of questions in order, I believe, or... rest. And let time pass.
Your mind comes bearing questions, Watcher.
I don't know,
The birthing bell. It is where I could draw new souls into the world. I recall some of the memory of it through what you have seen, but not all. Yes. Yet, I believe you only saw a small part of the birthing ritual. It is not all in a moment, nor in a day. It is a journey of many years between the child, the mother, and I.
There was much I could do to aid the mother. Some sought the physical comforts of ritual to steady their thoughts. Even Adra from the bell. Others would seek advice, words of counsel for the days ahead. I was able to provide drafts, tinctures, and a reading of the child's spirit, all to strengthen the mother. Can you tell me about the birthing ritual?
The ritual was one of many steps. It took many tens of years to carve them. But always, the child's thoughts were there to guide me, from the moment it began to awaken, to the three seasons within the mother, to the birthing day, and the years to follow. The child's thoughts, that is where it began. The expectant mother, I could often sense her thoughts, and those of her child, before she could. I would soothe her, free her from the panic of questions. I would sound the memory of the birthing bell atop the plateau in her mind, letting the memory of the vibrations fill my thoughts and hers. Often, the child's soul could hear it too, so the sound of the bell echoed in the mother's thoughts.
You sense the mother's thoughts? Sharing memories and thoughts can bond lives together, as can hardships, and most of all, the sharing of what is familiar. The bell itself provided shelter for such thoughts, opportunities to see deep into the crevice, hollows in the rock where one could find shelter, clefts where you could feel the Adra all around you. As she speaks, you feel your legs bent, crossed, and the warmth of walls around you, and blankets woven thick beneath you. Such shared images can bond souls even tighter and allow them to draw strength from each other. You mentioned the ritual lasting years. What would happen after the birth? Once the pain is channeled away and the mother and child breathe again, I sound the birthing bells on my wrists and allow the mother to hear the child's thoughts, the ringing echoing in each other's thoughts. The bells open the way between them. Let her feelings pass into the newborn and let her feel the child in return. And when the feelings meet, that is when I weave another memory and leave it tied in their minds. Did these bells play an important part of the I heard someone moaning, like an undead thing. Did these bells play an important role in the birthing process? Yes, and for years after, I gave a set to the child after delivery. It is a reminder of the memory the mother and child shared. You feel an odd sensation, a warmth, and you can feel a smile being shared. Then it flickers, and it is gone. As the bells coax the child forth, so they accompany the child onwards, fastened about the wrist, to care for him in mind and body. There is no magic in it except for the magic of practicality. If a child sought to leave their cradles or escape their cribs, the mother could know through the warning of the chimes alone. At times, if the bond was strong, so would I. The sensation of a smile comes again, slower, more knowing, between you. If not watch, children, much trouble may be had from tiny hands. The chimes are kept until the child needs them no longer. When I no longer can hear them sounding in my mind, I know their spirit has changed, and the bonds we shared are long gone. This shedding may last many years, or but a few, but it is necessary. You watched over these children for years after their births? Children are fragile things. Even the ties of blood and mind may not be enough. They must be watched, and even then, the body may fail the mind. But if watched, even the most sickly child may cling to life if determined enough, and many of their words were tied to me. If a child's spirit failed, I could sound the chimes in their mind and grant them strength, even from afar. It did not always serve, but it gave hope. It sounds like you've seen tragedy, too. Enough to never wish it to feel it again. In the times before the bell, children who died were cast upon the waters of the lake beyond the bell. Sometimes, while alive, if their past and futures were deemed weak. It was a different time. Children retreated carelessly. Those times are past. Are we done?
Your mind comes bearing questions, Watcher.
Watcher.
And I, you. In asking, we reveal ourselves to each other. It is because I once believed I was one. The birthing bell. It is where I could draw new souls into the world.
Huh. The birthing bell lies deep in the great forests of the Deerwood, at the borders of Glamfellen lands. Surrounding it, barely a town, not one you would find on any map, but it held an important place for those there, even if we were far from the beaten track. Small families, tied like a knot, joined the wrists in mind, in thought. All were welcomed, all had purpose. Should we be going there? Barely a town.
Yes. Yet, I believe you only saw a small part of the birthing ritual.
Should we be going to this place? Huh. Okay, since I don't know anything about any village, you know, I think that it would be Deerford Crossing again. Oh no, actually Elmshore. But I don't remember anything like a little town. So we're gonna try the sleeping thing, which is my backup plan. See how you like a little rest for size. Ooh! That worked. Oh, Sagani, you rescued Lord Sidrek also. Well done, Sagani. You find yourself back in the space inside the Grieving Mother's mind. It is familiar this time, and even though you feel you have seen countless births from this vantage point, something fills you with unease. The sky has darkened, and a mist has risen from the forest to hem you in. You are trapped. You hear something. The sound is strange, dissonant, like warping metal. You grit your teeth against the noise, and yet, as it rises, the eerie melody drives the numbness from your limbs and clears a space in the mist. Focus on the chimes. The noise resolves into a dull tone. As it resounds through your bones, you see that your hands are in motion. And once again you are drawing forth life, something warm and fragile struggling into the world. This scene feels familiar, a moment you have lived and dreamed a thousand times before, and yet something ominous gnaws at the edges. Focus on the woman's cries. The woman should be in pain, the natural pain of childbirth. You know this, but it is faint, distant, and you realize that you're soothing the pain with your mind, smoothing out the eddies of pain and relaxing her thoughts just enough so that she can still push from within, push the child forth. You are taking that pain onto yourself, but the pain has layers. One is a pressure, a familiar, welcoming pain, and the other... It is sharp, a razor at your consciousness, more recent than this memory. And as you try to recall how you've reached this place, you feel the same hollowness inside yourself, a pit filled with the clawing winds of a Beowulf. The very thought fills you with disquiet, like the memory of a nightmare. Focus on the child, the movement of your hands. As your hands move, you hear the sound of chimes, clear and sharp, yet somewhere distant they seem echoed by something else. Wails of sorrow, tolling bells, is impossible to tell. Okay, we really didn't focus on the hands or anything, child at all. Draw the child forth. An inexplicable sense of dread fills your soul as the child makes its journey to you, push by push. A malicious presence seems to surround you, and you lead forward to shield the child. At last the baby emerges, wet and ruddy from its journey. A lifetime seems to have passed as the newborn moves from womb to world, and another seems to pass as you cradle the trembling child, waiting. Let me guess, it's hollowborn. The child cries out, its cry full of life, full of soul. The chime echoing in its thoughts, filling it with its welcome. The soul is blurred at the edges as if you are viewing a soul from within a soul, but it is there. It is alive. The woman before you is weeping, and at her first cry, her hands reach out for it. Surrender the child. You surrender the child to her, something you have done many times before, and as your hands move, the dull clangor sounds, and you feel a weight hanging from your wrist. You look down and see bones, tiny and malformed, hanging from a string about your wrist. They are heavier than they should be, and as they clank together, they make a noise like funeral bells. The mother is too intent upon her newborn to pay you any heed, and so you hide your wrist behind your back. She need never know, can't ever know. As you hide the bone chimes, you shiver, in relief, with premonition, at the chill wind that suddenly sweeps the plateau. I had another dream about a delivery at the birthing bell, but this one felt strangely distorted. There was an ominous undercurrent, and I got the impression that all was not as it seemed. This woman does not fully understand her own past. If I am to learn who she really is, I may have to dig deeper into her story. Okay, she wants to talk.
Your mind comes bearing questions, Watcher.
Sure does. I walked again in your memories. This time they felt strange. I would see them again. Your vision gives way to waves of feeling, while you feel the jagged marks of violence you passed before. This time, the path is easier. There is no resistance, and you set about casually harnessing her memories, focusing on the one you seek. There is a slow rush, a warmth, and your thoughts enter as before, circling the memory you shared when you first met. You find yourself back into space inside the grieving mother's mind. It is familiar this time. And even though you feel you have seen countless births from this vantage point, something fills you with unease. Okay. I'm not going to read this all again if it's identical. Same. Hands in motion. It's the same thing. Just reading, guys, to see if it's the same. Alright, retreat from the memory. I walked again in your dreams, thoughts, and I believe your memories. Oh, I didn't see. With effort, the scene bleeds of color, and your mind becomes your own again. The grieving mother stands silently before you. She seems unaware of what you've seen, or that you've entered her memories at all. A mixture of curiosity and fear wells up within you. She raises her left hand, the chiming at her wrists quelling the rise within her. She is frightened, but curiosity anchors her.
What did you see in my memories? I would hear you speak of them.
Why can't we talk about them? Either tell her never mind or it's no matter, continue on. Never mind, I had other questions I wanted to ask you. Not sure, guys. What's that you're wearing on your wrist? She extends her hands and the small chimes on her wrist sound at the motion, just as they sounded in her memories. The chimes are finely crafted of white Adra. They are wrapped around the grieving mother's wrists with tiny woven braids of hair of different colors, from white to black, brown to blonde. You feel as if you're noticing them for the first time. I'm remembering Heravius's comment about the brown and blonde-haired people. To Adair, that was funny. If the birthing chimes were given to newborns, why do you wear a set now?
There was no child to carry it.
And suddenly there is a rasping cry across your consciousness, and you see her flinch, visibly, as if struck. She raises her hands, and you see the chimes drape from them, yet they make no sound as she moves. Yeah, I want to ask her both. In your memory, they look like bones.
And carry the weight of 100 deaths. I know, Watcher.
This is about the Hollowborn, isn't it?
The Hollowborn.
The same chill you felt before is stronger now, as if it's welling up around your feet, to your ankles. You feel a sudden urge to draw away, as if from an unpleasant memory.
The Hollowborn have a future. They can be saved, and the Tells spoke of such.
How would you know? Have you seen this future?
They can be saved. They must be saved. You have seen the beauty in childbirth. What good came into the world there on the plateau? You helped me recall it. It is a memory we shared. It is the truth.
In the memory, you hid the chimes on your wrist from the mother. Why? It is not what I hid, but what she saw. She couldn't know. The grieving mother squeezes her eyes shut and brings her hands to her ears. You have woven truth for countless mothers. How can I trust what you tell me? Truth is shaped by belief, by choice. It is coaxed from chaos like a child from the womb. No more of equivocation. What really happened at the birthing bell?
And what would you consider real, Watcher? The truth that was experienced and remembered? Or the one that burned out only to be swept under the rug and forgotten like ash from a fireplace?
What happened mattered. Forgetting it doesn't make it less real.
And how much of your own life has been lost to the error of memory? How many loves and betrayals were colored with the false hues of emotion? A pity to wonder how much of your own life happened the way you recall.
Huh. Try the other option.
The birthing bell. It is where I could draw new souls into the world. I recall some of the memory of it through what you have seen, but not all.
But what did you do when the Hollowborn came?
The curse.
There was a slight chill between the two of you, a current of emotion. The next thoughts come slowly, almost frightened, into your mind, like terrified children blanketed with a mother's fear.
You speak of the curse that fell upon the children. This curse that has fallen on this country.
Mm-hmm. She lowers her head. Something seems to surround you. A mist, heavy and thick. As the grieving mother looks inward, it closes in, threatening to choke you. Finally, she raises her gaze, and the mist retreats. I know only that it is a scourge upon every hearth in the Deerwood, and one that threatens to tear this country asunder.
And I, you. In asking, we reveal ourselves to each other. It is because I once... The birthing bell. It is...
How odd. I just realized that she wears Audra chimes around her wrist, the very chimes she claims she always gave to newborns. When I asked a grieving mother why she wore birthing chimes, she mentioned the Hollowborn. She believes they can be saved and feel that it's critical that we find a way to restore them. I pressed her and she became evasive. I know there's more to the story, but I may have to spend more time with her in order to break through the lies she's woven around us both. All right. Which means, maybe more sleeping. Our last section of the keep should be done soon. Nothing yet. Let me check this. I wonder if we've run across this Lord Sidrock. If we can find him in the keep. One day and 5 hours. She doesn't want to talk. One more. Aha! The morning is cold and silent. You are upon the plateau of the birthing bell, and there is no sound, no wind. The sky is a smooth, mortared gray. The forest beneath the plateau, nothing more than a jagged, black silhouette. Even the rock, the Adra around you, it feels colder. The sun's warmth bled from it. Against the cold black drop of the sky, you see the great birthing bell hanging from its arch of Adra. Its surface is tarnished, and the shadows inside the bell are dark, still. It seems to press down upon you, or simply, sadly, watching as if standing above a grave formed from the table of the plateau and the remains of the mother's womb that now covers its surface. And there is something heavy in your hands. It breathes, gurgling, slick and wet, yet that is all it is. You find yourself filled with fear. You don't want to look at what you are holding. You don't want to touch it with your mind. And it is all you can do. It is all you can do to not cast it from you. Well, we don't want to look at it, but let's look at it and examine what lies in our hands. The mass before you is vacant, flesh in the shape of a newborn. Bubbles of saliva bunch at the mouth, expelled by its steady, gurgling breath, its arms, legs, head lolling, limp. No thought, no struggle, no desire to cry in protest or pain. There is nothing from within. There is an absence in your hands. Your hands tremble, shake, and the silence is broken as the chimes on your wrists echo with the trembling. And the chimes do not echo in the thoughts of the mass in your hands. There is no soul within to hear it. Reach out with your thoughts. The only emotions blanketing the plateau are the pain of the mother. The child breathes, its heart beats, but it makes no cry. The child feels light, empty. There is no joy in it, no fear, no thoughts at all. Yet in the hollows inside it, it breathes, a thing of habit, not life. You cannot move. Your trembling has subsided, and the birthing chimes on your wrists are as still as the child. The mother is crying, eager to see, begging to see the child. You feel a sudden spike of fear, of being hunted. If you give the child to the mother, you will be blamed, and her anguish and rage shall fall upon you. She will not spare you or anyone you love, of this you are certain. But you did not cause this. You don't think you caused it. And the mother begs, her arms outstretched. Well, I suppose we don't have a choice other than to hand her the child. The chimes sound once more as you give the child to its mother, and as the chime fades, there is the eager gleam, the welling joy, the questioning, and you draw upon it deeply, letting the hope stream into her eyes, letting her ears fill with the cries that you have heard countless times past from other children on the bell. Are we giving her the illusion that the child is normal? You hear the laughter in the mother's voice, in streams of tears that run down her face, and with a practiced motion, you weave a life that will never be into her eyes and thoughts. She will care for the child as if it were whole until you set her free. She will care for it until you find a way to heal what has happened, until the reality cannot be dispelled anymore. And still, cradled beneath the weeping woman that birthed it, the child in her arms does not hear the cries of the mother, does not react. It is an empty thing that breathes and carries nothing within it. And the chimes on your wrists lie still. They are bound to you like chains, never to sound inside a newborn's mind ever again. Hello, grieving mother.
Your mind comes bearing questions, Watcher.
I saw a hollowborn at the birthing bell. The grieving mother's head bows, and she raises her hands, cradling them slowly so the chimes do not sound as she moves them. You feel a chill in the air, as if the vault of your mind is growing too large for the thoughts within, and your breath is laced with a chill. To her horror, you hear her breathing, ragged, hacking, but strangely steady, and you can see saliva bunching at the corners of her lips, becoming thick ropes of drool that cast themselves down her chin. Ew. There is a smell of blood in the air, new, wet, and the salt, sharp tang in your mind. Coupled with this is the smell of sodden undergarments clawing at your senses. Oh my gosh, so she's drooling and peeing herself and there's blood somewhere? Are you alright? She doesn't answer, and you don't think she even heard the question, or even knows someone is speaking to her. You sense no thoughts, no awareness from her at all. Huh, it's like she doesn't have a soul now. Need a little drink. Her clothes are wet. It is as if she is burning with fever beneath her tangled hair and beneath her threadbare robes, as if she is giving birth. With a slow hissing intake of breath, her head rolls back on her shoulders, her eyes pressed tightly together like the lids of a newborn. Yet past the lids you can feel the piercing stare, vacant, cold. Horribly, you sense nothing from her, not a thought, like the hollowborn you held in her memory. Well, I got an itch on my ear. And, okay, got it. Alright, you know if you try and pull away now, she will vanish into herself and vanish from your thoughts, perhaps forever, and you have a terrible feeling that whatever connects the two of you will be cut. She is as helpless before you as a child, and you search her thoughts for a way to coax her to you. Excuse me. Throat sound. Imagine the cries of the newborn. Is there any more after 7? No. Okay, share a memory of peace and comfort. She jerks slightly before you, then her head tilts, and the steady breathing breaks, and she gives a racking cry.
I thought it was my doing. I thought that I had stilled it with my thoughts. The child. It was just a child. What was done with it?
She swallows, so dry and rasping, you feel it in her thoughts as you hear it. Wow, so she's blamed it on herself the whole time. She thought that she actually did do it. Right, said that she hadn't done it, and she thinks she hadn't done it. So, Dead. More like undead. You helped give birth to a hollowborn, yet you made the mother think otherwise. Her breathing is steady again, but there is a life in it where there was not one before, and her emotions are building in her. Apprehension, confusion, welling up. She seems afraid to do more than simply be aware the memory is there. Okay, so well, we've got the narration with the ellipses going on and the pauses.
It was not the last hollowborn on the birthing bell, and never again did I hear a child's cry.
You have found a death within me, one that many women have borne within them. The words swirl with impulses and weight, spiraling around her, and you feel as if you are being dragged into it. I sought to serve women in need, and instead, my hands ushered no new life. What happened next, I bear the responsibility for. What happened next?
The first birth was the deepest, the saddest. Nothing I could do could find the child's spirit, guide it to him.
You feel a strange absence between you, as if your thoughts are being shared across a great distance. The thought bleeds out for a moment, then returns, sharp, near, personal. I could not understand what had happened, what I might have done. I could not dwell on that thought. The child was always there, always a reminder of what had happened, a marker. I made her care for it. I made them all care for it, until I could find what I had. What had gone wrong? But the Hollowborn, it wasn't your doing. It happened elsewhere.
Little word of the outside world reached us. It was enough time for rage and pain and grief to guide hands. I feared what would happen to the children. What would happen to me? Every mother knows her womb may shed a stillborn, but these cold, soulless creatures, the parents wouldn't have understood. And fear of the unknown breeds violence.
What happened then?
I held their minds within mine. I shaped and guided them as long as I could. And with each passing day, each new birth, the strain grew. And the more I felt my control slipping, the more I focused my thoughts. Eventually, even I succumbed to the power of my own illusion. I'd woven the threads so tightly that I could no longer see through them.
And then, one morning, I heard funeral bells tolling in the village. The sounds of wailing rose through the mists. A mother had died, her mind so focused on the care of her hollow-born child that she neglected even to feed herself. Oh my god. And with that, the illusion broke. The townsfolk saw their hollow-born the way they were, not the way I'd wished them to see. By the end of the day, they'd begun to look at me differently, too. Oh, crap. The whole village goes against her. I did not understand what had happened, but I knew enough to flee. Yeah, good idea. And every suspicion that surfaced, every faded memory of what I'd done, I pressed it down, tucked it away. She feels cold, lonely, rigid. My skill failed me, but I did what was necessary. I regret the mother's death, but how much worse would it have been had I not acted? There were other ways. You could have sought outside aid for the children, or fled if you'd feared for yourself.
The choices you speak of are not always clear in crisis. Not in that heartbeat when the first mother begged for her child and I had to decide what I would give her. How could I have known where that path would lead, or that there were others seeking the same answers? And even so, that hesitation would have cost a young life.
The right thing is not always easy, and yet if we can redeem the lost children of the Deerwood, our struggle will be worth it. The grieving mother's mind is silent and still for several moments. She lets your words wash over her, seeping into the cracks in her own thoughts. Well, we got some nice experience points.
My actions only caused more misery. Worse, I took from an entire village. Made them as empty and helpless as the children I sought to protect. But you feel it was right to hold and direct their minds, even knowing the cost?
I don't have an option to say no, it was wrong. I'm justifying it here. I'm gonna say you did not know the cost then. We must often plot our courses with imperfect knowledge. Justifying it there too, as no other option.
A tapestry woven thread by thread, never seeing the pattern. So it is with the thoughts and dreams that move us, that shape our reality. Your words have soothed my mind, in ways I did not expect. I thank you, Watcher, for the gift of your sight, for using it to guide me out of the prison of my mind. Let us hope it can also free you from the illusions Theos has woven around you.
Yeah, at the end of the game. The grieving mother is still haunted by her actions at the birthing bell, as well as by her ultimate failure to protect the Hollowborn there. Nevertheless, she did her best she could at the time. If we find an opportunity to reverse the legacy, I know it will be worthwhile, whatever the cost. Quest completed, yay! I know, extra long episode, guys, but I really couldn't split this in half. It wouldn't make a lot of sense, would it? Okay. Well, with all this rest you've been getting lately. I don't know, can I find this guy anywhere? Lord Sidrak? A new forum, right? That's done. 22 hours for the training grounds, and that'll be it. Crucible night. Find the guy. I don't know where he hangs out, or if we can even be found at all. It's kind of like a mini game or something. Shock Mage. Oh, here he is! I say you've done quite well with the place. A little more gilding on the pillars, perhaps. Some marble. Oh. Didn't we talk to him before? Alright. Whoop. See ya.
I will wait in the place of your strength.
That would be here, I suppose. Have our cat back. And next episode, heading back to Radric's Hold to get rid of Radric, I suppose, or whoever's taking his place. Not even sure. Let's say something stirs in a great keep. Yet this may be the work of a new usurper after the throne, or mere superstition. Apparently Radric seeks vengeance upon me for having ended my life and has issued a challenge. It may be worth investigating in any case. Apparently. Might not be him. Anyway, so that's next episode. Thanks for watching. And yeah, see you next time. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.